Let's start. So let us recall the things what we have learned in the last class. In the last class, we have started with linear discriminant function. Okay, and then we have extended the notion of linear discriminant function to design a more robust classifier, which is called support vector machine. Okay, so we have discussed the support vector machine for two class problem or for verification problem in biometrics. Okay, so when we have when we have to solve the two class problem or solve the verification problem in biometrics, then we can prefer to have a support vector machine for classification purpose. Okay, and related to support vector machines, we have learned how to design a support vector machine classifier to classify the objects or classify the patterns into classes. Okay, so in the last class we have started with the equation W dot xi plus b, okay, W dot xi plus b greater than 0 when xi belongs to class C1 or positive class, okay, or it is found to be less than 0. If it is found to be less than 0, then we can infer xi belongs to class C2 or negative class. This is what we have obtained. Then we have seen the constraint when this constraint is found to be, that means when the class information is provided with the input feature vector xi, then we have seen that yi into w dot xi plus b will be found to be greater than 1. Okay, when yi into w dot xi equals to 1, then we can infer that the vector xi will be found to be lie on the support vector. Now we will lie on the hyperplane, okay, or boundary of the hyperplane. Now let us clear the related parameters which are used in support vector machine classifier. And if we consider this is C1 region and this is C2 region, okay, and this is your maximum distance hyperplane, okay, and these are the boundary, then you will have, so this boundary, the equation of this boundary on positive class will be w dot xi plus b equals to 1, and for negative class we will have w dot xi plus b minus 1. Okay, and for this, these are all these boundaries, both the boundaries are also hyperplane, okay, but which we have obtained in the halfway of this hyperplane region, which is known as maximum distance hyperplane. An equation of this maximum distance hyperplane will be w dot xi plus b equals to 0. Okay, that means here we will have so many feature vectors in class C1 region and C2 region. If we consider our data set is two-dimensional, okay, data set is two dimensional, then we can have these feature vectors plotted on this feature space. Okay. So if we consider this is our ideal case. Ideal case means this these two classes are linearly separable by this maximum distance hyperplane w dot xi plus v equals to zero. Now if any feature vector is found to be lie on the margins, okay, suppose this is one such feature vector, this is one another feature vector from class C1, and this is one feature vector from class C2, this is another feature vector from class C2. So here we can see there are four support vectors. So two feature vectors lie on w dot xi plus v equals to 1. This is the hyperplane, and another hyperplane on the negative side, that is on C2. So here we can see there are two more support vectors which lie on w dot xi plus v equals to minus 1. Okay, so we will call these boundaries hard margins. Okay, hard margin. And what is b then? So, and this distance become b, this distance become 2 by mod of w. Okay, so mod of w means this mod of w infers this is the Euclidean space. That means 2 by mod of w, this is the distance between these two boundaries. Okay, so one boundary is associated with the positive class, another boundary is associated with negative class. These boundaries are nothing but the hyperplane, but the maximum distance hyperplane which is found in the halfway of this hyperplane region. This is the hyperplane region. If we consider this distance, so whatever the points or feature vectors will be found or will be available in this region, then that to be misclassified. Okay, that to be misclassified. For that misclassified feature vector, if some feature vectors of the positive class are found in the negative class, then there will be misclassification, or reverse can also be possible, that some feature vectors which are actually belong to class C2 or negative class can be found in the C1 region or positive class region. Okay, so in that case also there will be a misclassification. So for such misclassification, we have to compute the loss of the function. Okay, so that means either we can use the nonlinear classification notion, or we can obtain the maximum distance hyperplane in such a position or such in orientation, so that the intended feature vectors or the misclassified feature vectors will be classified more clearly. Okay, so classification will be successful when we have maximum distance hyperplane is change its position and orientation in such a way that the samples or the feature vectors of these two classes will be linearly separable. Okay, that means we have to change the position as well as the orientation of the hyperplane. So in both the cases, these boundaries are parallel to this maximum distance hyperplane. Okay, this middle line is called the maximum distance hyperplane, and boundaries are also called the hyperplanes, but these are not the maximum distance hyperplane. Okay, these are also called the hard margin. So hard margin basically is used to get the feature vectors linearly separable from one class to another by this hyperplane, maximum size hyperplane. Or this region will decide the binary classification of class C1 and C2. Okay, now if the support vector, if the position of the support vector is changed, or the if we remove one support vector from the boundary, either in the region C1 or C2, then we have to change the hyperplane. Okay, the position of the hyperplane as well as the orientation of the hyperplane. Now, what is B here? So, if we consider the maximum psi hyperplane, which is going through this region, okay, going through this region, then distance from the origin along the weight vector W. So what is weight vector? Weight vector is normal to this hyperplane. Now we can consider this is our weight vector. If this is our weight vector, and the distance from the origin along the weight vector, that means this is called B. Okay, this is actually this distance. If we consider that this distance, so this distance is called B by mod of W. Okay, this margin is 2 by mod W. We can prove this from school level geometry, that we can prove this the distance between these two boundaries are 2 by mod W. But what is that? What is B by mod W? Say B by mod W is the offset. This is called the offset. This is called the offset. So this offset is nothing but the distance, or the distance from the origin. If we consider another line, okay, which is going through the origin of this coordinate, Cartesian coordinate, okay, then from the origin along the weight vector W to the maximum distance hyperplane will be given by B by mod W. Okay, and this is the offset. So this is the distance from the origin along the weight vector W. Okay, and this weight vector is normal on this, normal to the maximum distance hyperplane. Okay, so we can have so many hyperplanes, but which is given in the halfway of this two hyperplanes, then that halfway hyperplane will be maximum distance hyperplane from the given feature vectors. Okay, so what we if we given a feature vector xi, then we will put this xi on the on this equation, that is w dot xi plus b. If this sign of this equation is found to be positive, then we will have this point on the positive side of the this hyperplane. And if the sign is found to be negative, then we will infer this xi is found to be on the negative side of this hyperplane. Okay. We have also seen in the last class that W dot xi plus b divided by mod of W greater than equals to some gamma. So this gamma is called the margin. Okay, this gamma is called the margin, and this margin is nothing but the distance from one boundary to another boundary. That means, or in other way, we can say that this margin is the distance from one feature vector of one class to another feature vector of other class. Okay, so if we consider x1 and x2, so x1 is the feature vector that belong to class C1, okay, and x2 is another feature vector which belong to class C2. Okay, and these two feature vectors are very very close to the very close to two margins, or it may be considered that x1 x2 will lie on the boundaries which are associated with class C1 and C2. Then the distance between x1 and x2, or in other way you can see that the distance between distance between two boundaries which are associated with class C1 and C2 will be gamma. Okay, so W dot xi plus v divided by mod of W will be found to be greater than equals to margin. Now what we have found from this equation, that W dot xi plus v greater than equals to gamma dot mod W. This mod W is nothing but this mod W is determined in Euclidean space. Okay, so margin, what we get from this margin, that 2 by mod W is nothing but the distance between two closest point of class C1 and C2. Okay, and if we consider these two points x1 and x2 lie on two boundaries, then we will have the distance 2 by mod W. This 2 by mod W is the distance between two boundaries, okay, or two hyperplanes, what we can say two hyperplanes or two hard margin. Okay, and there is a halfway, in that halfway the maximum distance hyperplane will be placed. Now we can write gamma dot mod W equals to 1. Okay, so we can apply the scaling, and by proper scaling we can have gamma dot mod W equals to 1. Okay, so we can write W x I plus b greater than equals to 1. Okay, greater than equals to 1, as we have seen that when we will have W dot xi plus v equals to 1, that means xi will be the support vector. If W dot xi plus v greater than equals to 1, then xi will not be the support vector, but xi will be a feature vector in C1 region. Otherwise, if we found W dot xi plus b less than minus 1, then we will say, or we can infer, that xi belongs to class C2 or negative class. Okay, that means here in this equation, so this is W dot xi plus b divided by mod W. This is the distance from the closest feature vector xi. Okay, closest feature vector xi, and this to be greater than equals to margin. Okay, if this is equals to margin, that means we can infer that xi will lie on one boundary which is associated with class C1 or class C2. Okay, otherwise we can have it should be greater than gamma or greater than margin, so that we can add the feature vector xi in safer distance. Okay, that means we need to place the hyperplane in such a way so that the xi, the feature vector, will be found in the safe distance from the bound both the boundaries of class C1 and C2. Okay, now if we consider a function phi w transpose into w, or we can write w dot w. Okay, for mathematical convenience, what we have taken, we have considered half before w dot w. Okay, now we have to minimize this function. Okay, we have to minimize the w and we have to maximize the bias. If we maximize the bias, that means we will have the feature vector in the safe distance from both the boundaries. Okay, that is why we want to maximize the bias and we want to minimize the W, okay, weight vector. So here in this function phi W, we want to minimize the fun. We want to minimize this function in terms of W. So this function is given by half of this function is given by phi W equals to half into W dot W. Okay. So here dot is the dot product. Now the trivial value of this function will be zero, but which is not required. If we obtain such trivial value, then the objective of this objective of getting the minimum value for weight vector will be. So we want to maximize the bias, or we want to minimize the W under some constraint. So what that constraint, the constraint that we have derived, yi into W xi plus b greater than or equals to 1, this is our constraint. So under this constraint, we have to minimize W or maximize bias B. Okay. So this is our constraint. This is our constraint. So under this constraint, we will minimize the function phi W. Okay. So now we can write a function L of W comma B. So this is called the Lagrangian function. So this Lagrangian function is given by this expression L of W comma B equals to, we can write half of W dot W minus summation over alpha I yi into W dot xi plus b minus 1. Okay, this summation over alpha I yi into W dot xi plus b minus 1. So this, where this subscript I will vary from I to m. What is, so m is the total number of training samples. Okay, and these training samples are nothing but the m number of feature vectors. Okay, and this m number of feature vectors will be obtained from some biometrics evidence. It may be fingerprint, it may be thumbprint, it may be iris. Okay, it may be offline signature. So these feature vectors will be obtained from some biometrics evidence, and then this m number of feature vector will be used for training. And when we will use these feature vectors for training, then after training we will have some model classifier. Okay, and we will use this model classifier to classify the unknown sample. Let us consider the unknown sample as p. Okay, so when we classify with this classifier model the unknown sample, the unknown sample will have no class information, only the feature vector that we can obtain from this unknown sample p. Okay, and using this classifier model is designed using this m number of training samples or m number of feature vectors. When the classifier is ready for classification, then we will use some unknown sample, and from that unknown sample we will extract or we will obtain the feature vector. And in that equation, which is used for linear discriminant function WXI plus B equals to 0. So in that equation, we will put the feature vector which is obtained from unknown sample, and then we will check the sign of that function. Okay. So sign may be positive or negative. So according to the class information will be decided for the unknown sample P. But in that case, we so before we obtain the class information of some unknown sample, we have to decide about the W and B, weight vector and B. Okay, so from that training model or classifier model, we will obtain the value of W and B. And when we will obtain from the classifier model, then we will put this value of W and B in the linear discriminant function. And with the help of the feature vector, which is obtained from the unknown sample, we'll decide the class information of the unknown sample. Okay, so that means here from the unknown sample, only feature vector will be used. But this classifier model will give you W and B, weight vector and bias. Using this weight vector and bias, we can decide the class information or the label of the unknown sample P. Okay. So now L of W, comma B will be minimized in terms of W and will be maximized in terms of B, bias B. Okay. So that means del L by del W, we will obtain the partial derivative of this Lagrangian expression L with respect to W. And again, we will obtain the partial derivative of this Lagrangian expression L with respect to bias B. Okay. Now let us consider the partial derivative of this Lagrangian expression with respect to W. Okay. So this becomes W. This is the first term. Okay. And here we can expand this function, expand this expression. So half of W dot W minus here we will obtain summation over alpha I yi W dot xi, okay, minus summation over alpha I yi b plus summation over alpha I. Okay. Now this summation over alpha I yi b and summation over alpha I, both these terms are independent of W. Okay. So therefore, these two will be getting cancelled. Okay. So summation over alpha I yi b and summation over alpha I, these two gets cancelled. And what will be remaining then? Then remaining term will be summation over alpha I yi xi. Okay. So this is the partial derivative of the Lagrangian expression L with respect to W. Okay. So this equals to W minus summation over alpha I yi xi. And we can so to minimize this function, we can equate this expression to zero. Equate this expression to zero. So what will be the W? So W becomes summation over alpha I, yi, and xi. Okay? So here we obtain the W in terms of summation over alpha I, yi, and xi. Okay? Where xi is the feature vector, y is the class information. And here alpha I in this Lagrangian expression, alpha I is known as Lagrangian multiplier. Lagrangian multiplier. Okay. Lagrangian multiplier. Okay. So here we have obtained the partial derivative of this Lagrangian expression with respect to w. So in this function, in this Lagrangian function, we minimize the w and maximize the bias v. Now we will obtain the partial derivative of this Lagrangian function with respect to bias v. So let us consider the same Lagrangian expression L of W comma B equals to half of W dot W minus summation over alpha i yi W xi minus summation over alpha I yi b plus summation over alpha I. Okay, now we will obtain the partial derivative of this Lagrangian expression with respect to b. So the first term, half of w dot w, is independent of b, so therefore this becomes zero. Okay, or this gets cancelled, minus we will write, so summation over alpha I y I w dot x I, this is also independent of, the second term is also independent of bias b. Okay, so therefore this gets cancelled, so this becomes zero. We can write minus, we will write summation over, so the third term, summation over alpha I y I b, so here we can see that this is this term. So for the third term, we will write summation over alpha I y I. Okay, so only b is involved with this term, and rest of the terms are independent of b. So therefore, for the last term, we will get zero. So what is remaining? So summation over alpha I y I. Okay, now to maximize the bias, we will equate this summation alpha I, summation over alpha I y I to zero. Okay, so therefore we can write summation over alpha I y I equals to zero. This is another constant. Okay, so here we have obtained another constant, summation over alpha I y equals to zero. Okay, now let me write the Lagrangian expression L of W comma B equals to half of W dot W minus summation over alpha I y I W dot x I minus summation over alpha I y I b plus summation over alpha I. Okay, now in this expression we will put the w that we have obtained after getting the partial derivative with respect to w. Okay, so if we put the w in the first term, okay, half of w dot w, then since here we have w dot w, so here we can write alpha I alpha j. Okay, two different Lagrangian multiplier, alpha I alpha j, and then for yi, we can write, what is w? So w, we have obtained w as summation over alpha I yi.
Sir, no, sir. Sir, please change the page.
Oh, okay. Okay, let me write W. So what we have obtained when we take the partial derivative with respect to W, we have obtained W equals to summation over alpha I yi, and alpha I yi and xi. Okay, alpha yi xi. Now let me write the Lagrangian expression L of w comma b equals to half of w dot w minus summation over alpha I yi w dot xi minus summation over alpha I yi b plus summation over alpha I. Okay, where I varies from 1 to m. Now in this expression, we will put this w. Okay, so this w is obtained while we take the partial, while we have taken the partial derivative of w with respect of this Lagrangian function L with respect to w. Okay, now in the first term we will put this w, so we will obtain half of summation over alpha I alpha j, because here we have w dot w. Okay, so if we consider this is two different vectors, okay, w dot w, then we can obtain two different multipliers, alpha I alpha j. Okay, and for yi yj we will obtain, and here we will obtain xi xj. Okay, and for the second term, we will write summation over alpha I alpha j yi. This w will be replaced by this. Okay, so therefore we can write alpha I alpha j yi yj, okay, and xi xj. Okay, and remaining terms will be same. So remaining terms will be the summation over alpha I yi b plus summation over alpha I. Okay. Now from this equation, and what we have obtained for alpha I yi b, for alpha I yi, we have obtained alpha I y summation over alpha I y equals to 0. Okay. So
yes,
this gets cancelled. Okay. So what we will obtain? Finally, we will obtain summation over alpha I minus summation over alpha I alpha j, okay, yi yj and xi dot xj. So this is the expression that we have to maximize for different values of alpha I and yi. Okay, so this expression, this is the expression, this is the expression. Okay, now here Lagrangian multiplier will always be greater than zero. Okay, that means the value of this Lagrangian multiplier will always be positive. Okay, now when alpha I found to be zero, so that means this alpha, the corresponding feature vector xi for the alpha I, when the alpha I or Lagrangian multiplier is found to be zero, that means the corresponding feature vector is non-support vector, or the feature vector which is not the support vector. Okay, and when we have obtained the high value for alpha I, so that will infer that the corresponding feature vector will be found very close to the bounded. Okay, or it may be a support vector, or if we obtain the extraordinary high value for alpha I, then we can infer the corresponding feature vector xi will be some spurious points or will be some noise. Okay, so depending upon the value of alpha I, we can decide about the feature vector. So whether the feature vector will be some non-support vector, or the feature vector which is not support vector, or it is the feature vector which is found very close to the bounded, okay, or hyperplane. So depending upon the different value of alpha I, we can decide about the feature vector, so that to be either close to the boundary, or that to be some spurious point or noise, or that may be some non-support vector, or the feature vector, ordinary feature vector, which is obtained either in class C1 or C2. Okay, so now consider P is an unknown feature vector or unknown sample. Okay, unknown feature vector. So we don't know about the class level of this unknown sample. Okay, so we have to assign the level to this unknown feature vector P. Okay, so now how to get the class information? So we will use the same linear discriminant function. Okay, so the difference will be that the only difference is that from the training samples we obtain a model classifier. Okay, and that model classifier, from that model classifier we have obtained W and B. Okay, W and B. So B to be determined later, but we have obtained the W. Okay, if B is obtained, then we can write a function phi P. Okay, so phi P of W dot P. So in place of xi, we are writing P plus B. Okay, B is bias, W is weight vector, P is unknown feature vector. Okay, now in place of W, what we can write? We can write summation over alpha I, yi and alpha I, yi, xi dot p. Okay, so we have obtained W in terms of summation over alpha I, yi, xi. Okay, and we are getting the dot product of P with xi feature vector, okay, plus B. Now we will decide the sign. So that means here we will obtain the sign of this function. Okay, that sign will decide about the class level of this unknown sample P. Okay, so if we obtain If we obtain P equals to 0, that means P equals to 1, that means this is the support vector. Or if we obtain P greater than 1, then the P will belong to class C1. If P is, if this function value is found to be less than 1 or less than 0, that means P will be belong to class C2. Okay, if P is found to be negative, then P will belong to class C2. So by this, so this is the way by which we can infer the class information about unknown sample P. Okay. Now how to obtain the bias. Okay. So here we can have the bias B. We can write here B equals to half of, so here minimum of, we can write summation over alpha I yi, okay, x I dot xj, okay, and then we can obtain maximum of this summation over yi alpha I yi xi xj. Now on what condition we want to have this? So here I, for every I, yi becomes positive, and for here every I, yi will be negative. Okay, so under this condition we will have the minimum of the summation over alpha I yi xi dot xj plus maximum of summation over alpha I yi xi dot xj. Okay, so this will be the bias B, and we will, since we have obtained this weight vector in terms of the summation over alpha I yi xi, and here we have obtained the bias B. Now we can put this W and B in this equation, in this linear discriminant equation for some unknown sample, and then we can obtain the sign for this unknown sample, and this sign will decide about the class level of the class information about unknown sample. Okay, now this is what we have obtained for the linear classifier, or the when the samples of two classes are linearly separable by a straight line or the hyperplane. Okay, now the questions come when the data are not linearly separable. Okay, now if we can start from the one dimensional example. So suppose some positive and negative examples are given on this straight line. So these are the negative examples, these are the positive examples. Okay, so these circles are the negative examples, and this cross is the positive examples. So here we have positive examples. So positive examples are appearing at the middle. Positive examples are appearing at the middle of the straight line. Okay, positive examples. And negative examples are found. These are the negative examples. And negative examples are found, or negative feature vectors are found on the both side of these positive examples. Okay, now how to classify these examples, or how to classify this feature vector? Is this possible to draw a linear hyperplane? Any idea?
No, sir.
These feature vectors are linearly separable. So this feature vector, the position of these feature vectors are obtained in such a way that we cannot use the linear classifier or the hyperplane. So that to be classified these examples linearly. Okay. So that means here we have to perform some operation like we can transform these feature vectors into higher dimensional space or higher dimensional feature space. So how if we decide x-axis, on the x-axis these feature vectors, all these feature vectors are formed and we know their positions on the x-axis. Okay, now we have another axis, y-axis. This is x-axis, okay, and this is y-axis. Now we will have the data will be mapped, or the feature vectors will be mapped into two-dimensional feature space. So after adding this y-axis, now we have the two-dimensional feature space. Now in this two-dimensional feature space, we will map these feature vectors. Okay, and when we will map these feature vectors in the two-dimensional feature space, then we can obtain the hyperplane, and that hyperplane will separate the positive examples from the negative examples. Okay, now the question is how to transform these negative examples and positive examples in the higher dimensional feature space. So here we have obtained two-dimensional feature space by adding another axis y. Okay, now if we multiply this, so here the first point, if we consider the first example, this example, okay, if we consider these examples, so these examples will be transformed in the two-dimensional feature space by multiplying so if we consider this is 2.5, this is 0.5, this is points, this is 1, okay, this is 1.25, like this, then the first first feature vector will be mapped in terms of 0.25 value. Okay, so here we will obtain, here we can obtain another feature vector, here we can obtain another feature vector, here we can obtain another feature. So these feature vectors are negative examples, and for positive, here we will obtain, suppose the positive examples are given in this positions. Okay, and negative examples, these negative examples are transformed such a way that we obtain these negative examples in these positions. Okay, by multiplying some value of y. Okay, now after transforming this, now we can see that here we have obtained a subset of feature, here we have obtained a subset of feature, here we have obtained a subset of feature. Now a linear now these two feature vectors from which are obtained from two different classes will be linearly separable by the hyperplane. Now here we can draw a hyperplane which will separate the positive class from the negative class. If this is considered C1 and this is C2. Okay, now we can obtain this hyperplane in the higher dimensional feature space. First we transform the feature vectors into higher dimensional feature space, or map these feature vectors into higher dimensional feature space. Then we obtain the hyperplane which will linearly classify the positive examples from the negative examples. So this is the basic idea behind get the nonlinear classifier for the non-separable examples. Okay, so initially we will see whether this is linearly separable or not. So if the feature vectors are not linearly separable, then we will obtain the mapping of the feature vectors into higher dimensional feature space. Okay, in the higher dimensional, once we obtain the mapping in the higher dimensional feature space, then we can draw the hyperplane, and that hyperplane will linearly separate the positive examples from the negative examples. Okay, now when we obtain such hyperplane, we can also consider the loss information. That means the error that to be determined for the misclassification of the feature vectors. So ideal case is not possible. Okay, for some feature vectors will be there which will be misclassified, and for that misclassification we have to obtain the loss function, and that loss function will give you the error or the penalty for which the misclassification has been occurred in the feature space. Okay, so how to determine the loss? So the loss function, we can obtain the loss function, we can write L of yi equals to max of 0, 1 minus t dot yi. Okay, or we can write in terms of linear discriminant function or in terms of the constraint that will give us the information about the feature vector which will lie on the boundary, or which keep distance from the boundary, or which is on the other side of the boundary. Okay, so max of, we can write 0, 1, 0, yi into w dot xi plus v, okay, plus v. So this will give us the information about, so if we consider the intended class information is intended class information t equals to plus minus 1. Okay, now if this function, linear discriminant function, or the constant yi into w dot xi plus b gives us 0 means when we will found 0, that means the function L of yi becomes 0 when the intended class information and the given class information or the actual class information is found to be equal. Okay, that means the desired class information, the actual class information is found to be equal, then only we will have the loss function L of yi becomes 0. Okay, that means there is no error. Otherwise, if the desired class information and the actual class information is going to be mismatched, then this is going to be increased. That means the function, the loss function L of yi, the value of this function going to be increased, since this is proportional to the class information, given class information yi. Okay, or for some unknown sample, we can obtain this function value in terms of w dot xi plus b. Okay, and then we will check whether the sign of this sign of the class information for the unknown sample is matching with the intended class information or not. If it is not matching, then we will have the increased value of the for this loss function. Otherwise, it will become 0. And when it will become 0, that means the error is found to be 0. Okay, or the loss is found to be 0. Otherwise, when there will be a mismatch, that means the intended class information and the actual class information is not matching, then only we will have this function increase with respect to the class information y. Okay, so this is the function L of yi equals to max of 0, yi into w dot xi plus b. So this function is used to get the information about the loss or information about the error to be determined in the support vector machine classifier. Okay, now how, since we are talking about the mapping of the feature vectors into higher dimensional space, now how this mapping is done? For the one dimensional data, we can obtain the mapping easily, because by adding one more axis, y axis, we can obtain the mapping of the one dimensional data into two dimensional feature space. So that is not a very difficult task. But for two dimensional data or three dimensional data or four dimensional, that means if we have more than two attributes or more than three attributes or had d dimensional attributes, okay, for a feature vector. Now for those feature vectors, we have to obtain a higher dimensional feature space, and in that higher dimensional feature space we will map the d dimensional data and get the nonlinear classifier. Okay, so nonlinear classifier, maybe we can obtain like this. So these are the feature vectors. Okay, these are the feature vectors. So in this case, how the classifier will be obtained? So this will be the nonlinear classifier or nonlinear. This is not the linear. The hyperplane that we will obtain will not be linear. Okay. This will be nonlinear hyperplane. Now, how to obtain this mapping? So we can use some kernel trick. We call this is kernel trick. Okay, kernel trick. So by kernel trick, we can obtain this nonlinear mapping into higher dimensional space. Okay, so by kernel trick, we can obtain the mapping of the feature vectors into higher dimensional, and then we will obtain the hyperplane. Okay, so we can have polynomial kernel. Okay, we can obtain polynomial kernel, we can obtain radial basis function or radial basis kernel. So what we will do that a Gaussian radial basis function. Okay, so we can have, so polynomial kernel may be inhomogeneous or homogeneous. So polynomial kernel may be classified into two groups. So polynomial inhomogeneous or polynomial homogeneous kernel. Okay, so we can obtain two different forms of polynomial kernel. We can obtain radial basis function. So what is the trick? Trick is that in place of dot product, we will use this kernel. Okay, polynomial kernel, radial basis kernel function. So this function will replace, or this polynomial kernel will replace the dot product, and with this kernel tricks, we can obtain the mapping of the lower dimensional feature vectors into higher dimensional feature vectors. So in the higher dimensional feature vectors, in the higher dimensional feature space, we will obtain the nonlinear hyperplane, and that nonlinear hyperplane will separate the positive class from the negative class if we deal with two class information or verification problem. Otherwise, if we have the multi-class problem, then accordingly we will place the hyperplane so that we can obtain the samples into their respective class in the region. Okay, any questions from here? If you have any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, we will stop this session now. And one more thing that I want to tell you. So regarding the home assignment that I wanted to assign in the last class, but it was not given. So today you can obtain the matrix okay. So this 5x5 matrix will be given to you. Okay, this 5x5 matrix, suppose here we have the gray level values. Here we have gray level values. So this is the matrix. Okay, so this matrix will be given to you. Now from this matrix you have to obtain the scale space. So I'm just telling you about the assignment that you have to submit. The solution you have to submit by the coming Sunday. Okay, so this is the matrix that will be given to you. And from this matrix, you have to obtain the scale space in the form of matrix. Okay. That means you will compute the octaves up to three octaves. Okay. So first you will obtain the scale space in terms of octaves. Okay. Up to three octaves. And secondly, you will compute the difference of Gaussian. The difference of Gaussian. Okay. And then you will compare the key point descriptor. Key point descriptor. And each of these steps will carry 5 marks. So to compute the scale space, 5 marks will be there. To compute the difference of Gaussian, 5 marks will be there. And compute the key point descriptor, 5 marks will be there. So total 15 marks assignment. Okay. So this is the assignment. So this is the assignment you have to submit. You have to submit the solution by coming Sunday. Okay. Any question you want to ask?
Sir, exam syllabus.
Yes?
Sir, exam syllabus.
Exam syllabus until today. Whatever we have covered today, so so this support vector machine will be included in the NSM syllabus. And this is the assignment, you have to submit the assignment by coming Sunday. Today is Friday, okay? Tomorrow is Saturday and then Sunday.
So what will be the exam pattern?
Exam pattern, only problems will be there. Problems and since there will be 60 marks, so first 30 marks will be there for objective type question. Okay, multiple choice, then objective type questions will be there for 30 marks, and rest of the 30 marks will have broad questions. So in the broad question section or group, there will be 4 questions. Out of 4 questions, you have to attempt any 3. Okay, and first group of questions will be mandatory. So this is the compulsory section, and section 2 will have 30 marks, and for 30 marks you have to attempt any three questions. So four out of four questions you have to attempt any three questions. Okay.
Sir, okay, can sir. You please provide us with some numerical problems?
From which part?
Sir, for whole syllabus.
No, no. In the last mid-sem exam, you have already learned about the problems. So similar type of problems will be there in the exam, NSM exam. Okay. Okay, that's all for today.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, yes.
Sir, can you extend the date for assignment submission?
When you want to submit?
Sir, from Monday, the end exam starts from Monday.
Coming Monday?
Yes, sir.
So I have not received the routine.
So it starts from Monday, right? It's been told.
No, you have been told that NSM exam will start from Monday, but we have not received any notification from academic section.
Then the exam won't start on Monday.
Okay, if the exam will start from Monday, then you can submit when your exam will end.
Next week, sir. Next Saturday.
Okay. Now, then you tell me when you want to submit.
So actually, if there is no official announcement about the end exam. So when will be the end exam?
No, if Monday is not going to be start, then I think it will be late. After 15th or after 20th. Oh. I even don't know when
actually we didn't get any confirmation, sir.
No,
actually,
you can get information, but I have not received any such information from academic section.
Okay, so who should we contact regarding this?
You may think that today is Friday,
okay.
And I have not seen any such notification in the website. Is this possible that by one day notification your exam will start?
Sir, but I don't know, sir, because Nanda Dulan sir asked for the dates of end exam, so.
No,
sorry, actually, ma'am.
My suggestion is that if your exam is going to be started from Monday, then you can submit after the exam.
Okay, that's fine.
After exam,
if your exam will not start from Monday, then I can give you more two more days. That is Monday or Tuesday. By Wednesday, you have to submit.
Okay, sir, fine. That okay.
That, is that okay for you?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Okay.
Sir, who should we contact regarding the end exam dates and all?
No. There will be a notification. Okay, that will publish in the website.
Okay, sir, fine.
Okay. And you can get information from academic section also.
Okay, sir.
Okay.